Hey everyone, it's Bobby from Lego Birds with another video in my Bird ID Through the Year series, and this one is going to cover winter field birds. And what I mean by field birds is the kind of birds that you would find in flocks in open farm fields or similar type habitats during the winter. And a lot of birders will drive around looking for these flocks, particularly after snowfall. When you get snow cover on the fields, a lot of times it pushes them to the side of the road so you can get better looks. A lot of times if there's no snow, they're way out in the field so you can barely see them. And first up is horned lark. And these are by far the most numerous of the species that I'm going to cover, at least in my area. Horned larks have sort of a pale brownish upper side, and really the facial pattern is the thing that stands out the most on these. So they have a black mask, and then they have some yellow in the face as well, especially in the throat, and then above the mask usually has some yellow as well. They also show a dark band here on the upper chest area, and sometimes you can see these little black tufts, or the horns where they get their name. A lot of times you will see them in sort of this horizontal or crouching type posture, and then at other times you'll see them more upright when they are alert. And at least in my area, this species is pretty much the basis for comparison to at least the next two species, which tend to mix into flocks of horned larks, and the horned larks usually are going to outnumber all of the other birds. So this is one that you want to know pretty well, but by and large, the identification is not too challenging on these. But just keep in mind that sometimes distance can play a role in increasing the challenge of the identification, because these birds are not horribly large. They're a little bit larger than sparrows, but if you're looking across a field at a couple hundred yards, that's a pretty small bird to see too many details on. Moving on, our next species is snow bunting, and these mainly are white on the underside with a darker back, and then they have sort of brown or sort of cinnamon colored patches on the chest and also in the face and the top of the head. When they are on the ground, you can usually see a white patch in the wing, but then that becomes readily apparent in flight with a significant amount of white on both the bottom of the wing and on the upper side of the wing. And these are going to show more white than pretty much any other sort of songbird, except for maybe some that have some pigment issues. And it makes it pretty easy to pick one of these out of a flock of horned larks, because you're just looking for that flash of white in the wings. And one other thing I will point out is that it has this sort of yellowish-orange bill, which the other species we're looking at don't have, and it really helps to contribute to the unique plumage and overall look that these have. And then we'll move on to Lapland Longspur, which, at least in Pennsylvania, always seems like the trickiest of these to find. These are a little bit smaller than the horned larks and snow buntings we just looked at, and overall these look very sparrow-like. They have a strongly patterned head, especially with this dark frame that you can see in the face. And often you will be able to see a little chestnut stripe in the wings here, which helps to set it apart from the sparrows. Another feature that you aren't really going to see in very many sparrows is all of this dark that you can see here in the upper chest, and oftentimes you can see it in the throat as well on longspurs. Especially on this one, you can see how dark it is. And you probably won't see very many that look like this, but if you happen to see one a little bit later in the spring, I just wanted to point out what the breeding plumage looked like. And at least in Pennsylvania, these tend to just be mixed into flocks of horned larks. And I'm lucky if I find even more than one or two a year, so definitely not very common in my area. And last, we will talk about American Pipit. These are somewhat similar to the others in terms of overall behavior and habitat, but I would say they are subtly different as well, and I usually don't find them mixed in with these other flocks. Occasionally, I will find a pipit mixed in with, say, horned larks, but I would say that that's less common than just finding a solo pipit or maybe a flock of pipits by themselves without any of these other species mixed in. This is another one that is somewhat sparrow-like, but you can see they really have longer legs than sparrows, and especially look at the difference in the bill, how thin this bill is compared to what you would see on sparrows. And the very weak facial pattern will provide a very easy way of separating this from Lapland Longspur. In addition to your sort of farm field type habitat, I do often find pipits right next to water, so along a riverbank or a creek bank, something like that. It's a pretty common place for me to find American pipits. Sometimes I will find snow buntings along our local lake, but generally none of these other species are attracted too much to these bodies of water. As you get a little farther into the spring, a lot of them will have the plumage change a little bit, so you end up more with this sort of buffy orange color on the underside with a grayer upper side compared to more of like the brown streaking and the brown upper side. And a lot of times you will see these bobbing their tails, almost like a water thrush or a spotted sandpiper or something like that. I thought it would be good to end this with a few practice birds for you to look at. So if you want to pause now so you can look at this and figure out what it is, and then I will run through the field marks. If we look at the bill, you can see it is not really that thin. It's shaped sort of like what you expect to find on a sparrow. Also, if we look at the face, you can see this dark frame around the cheek, and also you can see this sort of reddish stripe in the wing, which makes this a Lapland Longspur. And next up, we have this bird. And overall, you can see it is somewhat sparrow-like, overall brown with some streaking, but it does have this very thin bill compared to sparrows, which makes this an American pipit. And then we have this bird. And what do we see on this one? Well, it's got sort of a yellowish-orange bill, has brown upper side. You can see this big white stripe here in the wing, and also sort of these splashes of this brown or cinnamon-type color in the face, which means this is a snow bunting. Two more photos to go. You can see this one has a light brown upper side. It has yellow in the throat and this dark mask, which means this is a horned lark. Last photo, but this actually has three birds, so let's cover each of them. So on this one, you can see brown on the upper side. It has yellow in the throat and a black mask. So like the previous one, this is also a horned lark. Then moving on to this one, you can see extensive white on the underside with the splashes of cinnamon here around the neck and in the face, which means this is a snow bunting. And on this upper one, you can see it's very sparrow-like with a strong dark border here around the cheek and also some red here in the wing, meaning this is a Lapland Longspur. If you found this helpful, please consider subscribing to the channel or to my email list at lycobirds.com/email. It's free and easy to unsubscribe at any time, so if you change your mind later. And there are plenty more videos planned in this series, so I hope you will check back in and join me on my next one. Thanks for watching.